Hi, today I want to cover priming some boards, and I'm just getting a call from my girlfriend Jacqueline, and I want to do some demonstrate how I put together a palette, and a little bit about my girlfriend's laughing, a little bit about she's saying hi America, hi world, a little bit about you know, brush, you know, solvent safety and stuff like that. So here we go. No, that's okay. Okay, you're coming over. You're on your way. Great. Okay. So here's my new setup. IKEA butcher block table. Has wheels on one end. It's a little unwieldy. It's big, though. It's sturdy, though, and you can move it around. So let me put this down for a sec.
Here it is.
Here's my new setup. It's a piece of foamcore, black foamcore, right there. I got a box of 20 by 30 foam cores from Jerry's Artorama, and it comes in handy, and I always have some foam core. I'll show you, I have various uses for it, but that's a good thing to put your setup on. This is whatchamacallit, a pallet, a sheet of pallet paper. So I have like two sheets that I taped down with blue tape to the foam core so it doesn't slide around. Masonite might even be a better choice, because if you have to move this thing around, foam core is pretty light, could bend, could break if you have enough weight on it. So Masonite might be a little better for that. I got my colors. I use a wide variety of colors and paints. Often I won't have this whole spectrum when I'm doing a paint. I might, starting a painting, I might start out with you know, a few less colors. See all the reds I got? I always seem to use the reds. And for Christmas, I'll ask my girlfriend for paints from Jerry's Artorama, which I will plug. And I hope we can work out a deal at some point. I don't know. But yellows, I never use as much yellow as I think I'm gonna. Ochres, I use a lot of. It seems to dry out fast. Ochre. That neon pink, just in case. The orange, I like. It dries out fast. I don't seem to use as much of that. My real go-to things are, this blue is a permasol, Shiva permasol blue. That's a great blue, very, very strong. I do a lot of grass and greenery, so these greens are good. Ultramarine blue, French ultramarine. I've always been in my palette. I use a lot of that. This is blue black. It's pretty close to indigo. I'm surprised how much I use that. I use that more than I think I'm gonna. Venetian red, strong red. Let's see. Pale yellow and a deep yellow medium. Might be cadmium, and white. Obviously, I use a lot of white, and it's good to have that around. Let's see. I'll go to my brushes. Let me put this down for a sec. Oh, let's see. Wait a minute. Before I do that, palette knife. I looked at some instructional videos, and one person inexplicably said, "Oh, don't use a palette knife. Never use a palette knife." And it's like, sometimes when you're doing a big area, you know, big patch of blue or a lot of any one color, it's good to get your color out, mix it with linseed oil, you know, kind of like get it liquidy, and you need a palette knife for that. That's good. You don't want to mess, you don't have to mess up your brushes too much. This is a little wire brush for cleaning brushes, which I admit I do only very occasionally, because, and I'll get to why I do that or don't do that. These are obviously milk cartons that are just, I cut them like in half, and they last kind of forever. They're coated cardboard. That's duct tape on the bottom, so I go like so, because when you have a bunch of linseed oil there, you have a bunch of weight and a bunch of brushes in there, you don't want to accidentally knock them over, which I've done. So this one will be more for the solvent and just storing the brushes in a wet, you know, wet liquid. And this one is more for my linseed oil. And I'm going to put this down for one sec. And get my brushes. See if I can do this. These are the brushes I generally use. This guy is a chip brush. you can get it at Home Depot for like $1.50. That's like what, 2 inches? 2 inch brush. I start out my paintings, and I like to start out with big brushes and keep that. That way, I think human nature is to go towards little brushes and, you know, get that detail. Just, you know, get that detail. When you've been painting for a while, and I used to paint like that more. When you're painting for a while, you want to start up big. And I try to use a big brush as much as possible. And then I'll go on to smaller, slightly smaller brushes. This might be the most... Okay, sorry about that interruption. This might be the most, the most satisfying brushes I use. I'll give you, you can get some scale here, let's see. Ba 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 ba. It's a Filbert. It's a nice brush. I really haven't paid so much attention to different brushes, but that's a nice one. This one's nice for when you're doing a large area, but you're doing, you want that like sharp edge to cut in certain stuff. This guy, I don't use as much as I could, but this is a great, look how big this is. It is, what? It's a good 2 feet. And that can be good to practice on if you're a beginning painter. So you stay loose. Like when you're doing your first like drawing with paint, you can really be far away, and it forces you to stay loose. You know, you, because I think human nature is to, here, when I see people painting, usually in the demonstration videos, I'm painting on my refrigerator, not really, but, and I see people like with their little bar and stuff and holding the brush like this and, you know, doing that, it's kind of like, I don't know, you're losing some energy and you're losing looseness. So my big thing, I often catch myself going like this. I try to hold my brush like this, balance it. No matter what brush I'm using, I try to hold it loosely and paint that way. And that's a good, I think that's a good practice. And that's connected to, starting out with a large brush and seeing the big, big things, the big shape. Use that, big shapes, use that as much as possible. You can always go in on the little, with the little brushes. And some of my little brushes are funny. Like, look at this thing. This is like, I don't know, let's see. You can see that? It's like a few hairs on that. I mean, there are rigorous brushes that are almost literally a couple hairs. But these are, just have these little stubs on them. And these are a little better. These have a little more paint, kind of a good edge there. I use those a fair amount. And this little one's a good one, because he holds a lot of paint, a fair amount of paint for, as opposed to this guy. Holds a little more paint for fine detail. Let's see, what else can I say? So, let's see. Oh, two things about cleaning brushes and using linseed oil. Let me see. For years I used turpentine. Now I use this safe paint thinner. It's not super toxic, because turpentine is toxic as hell. You can just feel it. And it smells nice. It's that great, you know, that great smell of turpentine. But it'll get to you after a while. It really will. So I like to use this to thin the brushes and clean them out. And my oil, linseed oil I use, I don't use a wide variety of mediums. So I basically just use linseed oil to make the paint flow a little more. And the thing about linseed oil is, excuse me, don't ever, I think this applies to raw and boiled linseed oil, don't ever saturate a rag with it. Shouldn't saturate anything with it, but if you're just going to slop it on a rag and saturate it, the reason I say not to, it will combust. It'll self-combust. You can see it. Do an experiment. Get a rag, cover it with this stuff, saturate it. Out on the street, outside, definitely. Let it sit there. It'll burst into flames eventually. It's creepy. It doesn't seem to happen with paper towels, but I make great care not to saturate a paper towel with linseed oil. And I once did a job years ago, a decorative job near my home, and I was using rags and linseed oil, and I was had to go out and get something, and I was going to be really careful. I'm like, okay, I know this stuff's dangerous. I am going to put the saturated rags in a 5-gallon plastic bucket and cover it in water, and I'm gonna go out and get my stuff and come back. And I put the bucket outside, thank God. And I came back, and the bucket, it could bust it even under water, and to the water line, the bucket had melted and burned. So just so you know about boiled linseed oil, that's, don't be scared about it, but gotta be careful with it. And obviously, you have stuff, you know, toxic stuff, keep it away from kids if you have kids around. So I'm gonna put some of the safer paint thinner in here. I don't have too much left. You need to shake it up a little bit. It comes out looking milky. And I'll put my boiled linseed oil on there, sorry. And I don't know how much I'll edit this. I'm just doing it one cut. I'm just thinking it's going to be easier to edit. So here we go. See if I can't slop it all over. So Remember, I have my duct tape under there. So, if someone knocks it, and you have tall brushes hanging out of it, as so. You have a bunch of tall brushes. Yeah, press that tape down. And, you know, someone knocks it, or you knock it, it's not going to go, hopefully won't go all over the place. Let's see, my other thing is, sorry about this, people may or may not know about this. Olive oil, vegetable oil, or peanut oil, you can, it's oil, so that will clean off oil paint. You don't always have to subject your skin to this thinner, and you don't, the more you paint, you realize you're not have to spend 2 hours a day setting up and cleaning your brushes carefully. That depends on your temperament. Even this setup, to some people, might just seem, oh, chaotic, and the state of these tubes might horrify certain people, and they just want a neat setup, and I understand that. And a quick word about all my different grade paints. Again, another plug for Jerry's Artorama. I see, you know, what's on sale and what's good. Lucas is good. It's usually a good price. Georgian, Daler Rowney Georgian, is, I think, mostly student grade, but it's good. It works out. Winsor & Newton. Let me see, Shiva. I want to get more Shiva paints, because this Permasol Blue, it's a great blue. And I probably have a few others in there. And one thing I want to say is, maybe in my paintings, color isn't such an issue. And if people are attached to, oh, I love this certain red or blue or yellow and I need it, and this is the only thing that'll work, that's fine. I'm kind of like that with some blues, that Permasol Blue, and I always like an ochre. I think I use this richer yellow less than I use the pale yellow, and I always like that Venetian red and burnt umber. But if you have a particular thing, you only like one line of paints, that's fine, and it probably makes sense. It's probably easier to do that. But sometimes, let's say with a burnt umber, how great a burnt umber, it's a dark, deep color, receding color, how great does that have to be? Or a blue-black, how perfect does that have to be? Has to be good enough. What's my other little insights I wanted to tell you about? While I'm on mediums, while I'm on paint, actual painting materials, often at the end of the day, I'll be painting away, and I'll just take my brushes, bump, put them in this linseed oil, and just save them for the next day, then just wipe them off the next day. And when I do wipe them off, I use paper towels and I spread the, you know, I use them, I spread them out to dry. I even test them because I'm so gun shy about them combusting. It doesn't seem to happen so much with paper towels, that combustion. Something about the weave of cloth that helps that to happen. But I'm still very careful, you know. I won't just go off and leave a big pile of oily paper towels. I'll put them out at the end of the day, or put them in my wood stove, or if you're in an apartment or something, have a metal, you know, a metal container that closes tightly, or put them out at the end of the day. You don't want to kill everybody in an apartment building because you started some fire. I got to, let's see, the olive oil. Sometimes, let's see if I can do this. If you know you're going to have a real painty session, you can, even before you start, I'm just wiping olive oil on my hands. So I already got it there. And it's non-toxic, toxic obviously. And that'll help you clean up a little better. When all said and done, you know, you're done. Since I'm on materials, two things. Spray adhesive that I use to mount photos. When I'm using photos, I'll use that. That's pretty good. Multi-purpose adhesive. This stuff I use for coating the photos before I put them on the board that I'm using. And this stuff is great. It's horribly, nastily toxic. You need that. When I spray something, I do it. I have a fan pretty much always going out an open window. So I'll spray it right under the fan. Spray my photos. I'll put newspaper or paper towels down. And I'll get out of there. I mean, this stuff, you can just feel this stuff doing damage. It's just, I don't know what's in it, but it's nasty and toxic, and you can tell. So, let's see. What else do I got? So, I'm pretty much ready to paint right now, so that's good. And you saw my old setup. That's what it tends to degrade into. It's entropy after a few paintings. And then periodically you change your setup and it feels good. It feels great. Some people will need this setup, you know, every time they paint just to keep their head together. I don't seem to need it every single time. And let's see. Maybe I'll do a board next. Hi, so this is my, I'm back again. This is my paper palette pad. Got that, again, from Jerry's Artorama. If you have the money and you can spend a few $100 in bulk supplies, it's great. And the website is comprehensive, but hard to get through. There's just so much. If you get the catalog, it's a little easier to find stuff and order. And you can try different stuff. Every time I order paints, I treat myself to a couple different colors that I haven't used, you know, I haven't used yet, just to experiment. I have my basic palette over here. I showed you earlier my basic palette I use, but I try to switch it up a little bit every so often. And here is my, bear with me, here's my easel, and it's a good solid easel. My ex Donna got this for me years ago. Still works. The top part, there's kind of a clip thing that kind of broke at one point, so I use these cheap clips and they work okay. And this is a good palette, adjustable. You can lean it back. You can get them new for a couple hundred, few hundred bucks, and you can get them used if you look around. If you're lucky, you'll get one in good shape. So right now I'm gonna prime a board. This is a really nice foam core that they sell at Hobby Lobby. And I know some of their corporate practices aren't so great, but most corporate practices aren't completely great. So I don't know. My daughter tries to shame me not to go to use them. And basically I just go there for the foam core. This big 30-foot-by-40 piece is about $6, but they have sales occasionally, 40% off. So apparently Sunday night you go on the website, as if you're going to remember, but and see when the foam core sales are. So that can help. But it's a nice quality foam board. What I'm going to do is, let's see, put a coat of polycrylic, water-based polyurethane. I'm going to do it on each side. One side, I'm going to let it dry. The foam board is going to curl up, but don't worry, because you do the other side, then it evens out. So I'm going to put this on my tripod again, and I'll do it. I don't know how fascinating this is going to be to see. It's a little dark in here. You'll be able to see, I guess. So, excuse me for sniffing. I'm going to do one side, and I'm going to do the other. Oh, this is a quick little brush tip with these. Here, I'll come around so I can see what I'm doing. These chip brushes, which are cheap, get them at Home Depot or different places, and you can make them last if you see under the seam here, you put some wood glue, and even in the bristles you put some, you know, Elmer's white glue or wood glue with a little water. Then mostly clean it out. Leave a little bit of that wood glue at the bottom of the bristles and in that seam. And if you think of it, you know, they're cheap. You can just go through them and wreck them. But they'll make them last a little bit longer. Sometimes a lot longer. I've had some of these a long time. So this is my basic brush tool I use. What I'm going to do is just do one coat, then the other. And this polycrylic, that can stink up the joint too, you know. That can smell like in a closed room without ventilation. It can do a number on you. So be mindful of that. I get to seal the sides a little bit just in case. And this stuff on foam core will dry really pretty quick. So you don't have to be frantic about it, but do what they call keeping a wet edge. You brush into where you were starting from. I think you can already see it starting to bow up. And why I use foam core now as opposed to masonite. Masonite's great. Like 1/8-inch tempered masonite that you can get at Home Depot. And you can have them cut it there. And it's great, it's sturdy. I wouldn't use this on the masonite. I'd sand the surface of the masonite a little bit and use a primer. I know with art students, they always push gesso and they recommend gesso. I've gotten to the point where I use a white latex primer, white acrylic primer. just for walls and stuff. And so you look at it bowing. I'm going to let that dry, then I'm going to flip it. So I'm going to put this here. Where's my thing? Top, sorry. So I'm not washing the brush and stuff. I'm leaving it in here on its side with the top on. So that shouldn't dry out. 10 or 15 minutes, that shouldn't dry out. All right, I'm recording again. So this is drying. You can always put a fan on it. If it's really super humid, really wet and humid, you know, muggy day, you might want to use a fan. It's a little rainy outside, but inside it's pretty dry. I could put a fan on it to hurry it up, but this will dry to the touch pretty quick. If you can see this, this is another thing I've taken to doing. You can actually paint on this stuff. It's a foam board, Home Depot foam board, insulation. Not foam board, it's insulation for houses. It's pretty thick. And what I do, clear pink side, I sand it a little bit, prime it once or twice, then I put a semi-gloss latex, acrylic latex paint on it, and that gives you, like when you get to painting, painting on a primed surface, it can pull and drag. If you have a little sheen on it, the brush slides over it more, which is kind of nice. And another aspect, cool aspect to this is you can, it's thick, so you can, once you have your, let's say I was going to do a painting that consisted of two shapes, I could cut this. And I'd have this pretty thick edge. It's close to 2 inches, inch and 3/4. And I could put my frame, usually I use poplar frames, strips, right on the side there. And you're kind of ready to go. And it's, you know, it's light. And that's why I'm using the this foam board, because it's light. Masonite. You have, let's say, 10 sheets of Masonite, 10 paintings. That's a lot of weight. It's heavy. So I'm going to turn this off for a minute again. Okay, so it's been about 10 minutes. And this is dry to the touch now. It's slightly tacky, but it's not. I don't think it's really going to stick to anything. And you see how bowed it is? That'll take care of itself. And see how I put the can? It's been 10 minutes, so nothing dried out. All right, I'm going to do this side. Just earlier when I went out, I was talking to a neighbor whose kid, whose daughter is in Pratt, goes to school in Pratt, art school. And we're talking about, you know, what she's doing a little bit and how's it going and all that stuff. And she was saying, well, you know, she, you know, Jessica maybe wants to do something where she's with other people. She's not alone so much, and that's one thing, like with being an artist, a painter, or a writer too, I guess, or I guess maybe a lot of other people in the arts, but I know with painting, there's a lot of solitude, and you have to come to terms with that. It can get you a little nuts, but kind of like being a monk sometimes. You're just by yourself surrounded by yourself, surrounded by your work, and you have to be able to tolerate that. It can be tough. You know, these videos, there's a flurry of activity, and I'm talking. Usually, I'm painting, I'm listening to music, usually, or something. And if I'm talking, I'm just talking to myself. So here we go. It's already starting to flatten out. And I know for right now, I'm not going to put any more coats on this. So cover this up, wash out my brush. And yeah, the advantage of the foam board over this, let's say, is I don't have to, the foam board, I don't have to sand. And probably the nicest thing to me about, a thing that really blows my dress up is having boards that are ready to go, ready to be painted on. That's great. I'm going to put this in the sink. Sorry. I apologize for my old guy meandering, but I think I'm having a senior moment right now because I was going to say something. What the hell was I going to say? Jesus Christ. Okay, I was going to show you this. There you go. This is, I don't know if you can see this. So this is foam board, the painting I'm working on, and this is the back of it. So it's that foam board. I have strips of that pink insulation foam that I obviously cut into strips, and I use liquid nails. A caulk gun, you get it at Home Depot, and I cut this out. I have a weight, I press it on there, you know, I try to press it on evenly, and you know, let it sit, and when it's all done, it's structurally pretty sound. It's, you know, very lightweight. And it has this thick edge where I can put my frame. So, all right, there's my board. It's flat, it's pretty much flat. And that'll dry out. Be ready to go, ready to paint. So, that's it for now, I guess. See ya for the next one. Thank you. Subscribe to my channel, whatever you do.